Good morning, Parkside. Welcome to our online services today. We hope you are enjoying the series on the seven letters to the seven churches. I know I have. Today we get to hear from the church at Thyatira, a church that had compromised itself in taking on the colors of the world around us. I look forward to Pastor Doug showing us about that church. Enjoy the services, time in the Word, a time of prayer, and a time of worship. Again, thank you for joining us.
Savior, say, thy strength indeed is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me thine all in all. As Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. Lord, now indeed I find thy power and thine alone can change the leper's spots and melt the heart of stone. 'Cause Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. Paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow.
White as snow. Well, good morning, Parkside. Hey, thanks for joining us here this morning. Again, we're on video, and I look forward to, as all of you do, the day when we can be back together, and whether that's inside or outside, we'll be excited when we actually get to see each other and hang out together and talk and pray and just be a church together, gathering together. And my hope is that we can do that maybe sometime here in the next few weeks. In August, we're looking to have a parking lot service, so you'll hear a little bit more about that, but looking forward to that. Well, what I want to do this morning is I want to take you back to 1999, right before the millennium hit. In fact, my wife and I, our family, we were living in Seaside at the time. Cassie had just been born, and we were doing ministry on the coast and just having a great time over there. But at the beginning of that year, okay, leading up to 2000, Christianity Today asked a question that at the time I don't think they understood. I don't think they really grasped how important this question was going to be, not just when they posed it in 1999, but now, right, in this unprecedented time that we find ourselves in. And here was the question, so think about this. And the question is this: are you tolerant? Are you tolerant, right? Now, there's a buzzword for today, right? Tolerance. But there was a second part of that question. And the second part was this: should I be, right? Are you tolerant? And if not, should you be tolerant? And so here's what drove Christianity back then to ask that question. Because what there was is there was a growing movement, even back in 1999, there was a growing movement among churches to practice what pastor and author Charles Swindoll, if you've heard about him, what he calls tolerationism. Okay, not being tolerant, but an actual principle called tolerationism. And Swindoll says that tolerationism has become one of the greatest virtues, not necessarily good, but it's become one of the greatest virtues of an increasingly secular society. In fact, tolerationism today, there's many words that could describe tolerationism today, and they're again, buzzwords that you hear thrown around, words like open-minded, right? We need to be more open-minded or unbiased or sympathetic, right? Inclusive, liberal would fit into that. These are all, in my mind, simply words that describe this principle, this concept of tolerationism. Well, Swindoll believes that the word tolerant, which that principle comes from, it's changed. It's changed over the last 20 to 25 years, whereas many of us, and especially you, many of you might refer to tolerance as that principle where you simply disagree with somebody. You disagree with their values or their beliefs or their lifestyle. But what you don't do is you don't allow that to affect you. You don't allow that to impact you. You don't allow that in any way, shape, or form to change your beliefs or to alter your beliefs or your values or what you believe to be true or right. Well, this is where Swindoll would say tolerationism is different. Because with tolerationism, instead of putting up with the attitudes and actions of those that we disagree with, society, especially now, especially in 2020, society is increasingly expecting everyone, all of us, to simply and wholeheartedly accept and approve and possibly even mesh the beliefs and values that we have with their beliefs, right? To kind of see all the different beliefs together into one melting pot, and everyone just kind of grabs bits and pieces of all these different values and ways to live and things to believe in. You just kind of put together and you create your own set of standards. With tolerationism, right? Every strange idea and every immoral behavior deserves our affirmation as simply a normal alternative. Well, in this kind of society, here's the problem with that. In this kind of society that practices or really props up tolerationism, absolute truth, especially as it pertains to religion and ethics, it's going to get lost. It's going to get pushed aside. Or it's going to receive this label. It's going to be labeled as something that's unloving or narrow-minded or even judgmental, which in my mind raises the question, how can there be truth? Can there even be absolute truth if everybody's contradictory opinions are afforded equal value? In fact, I think the best way to illustrate this is through a video I found. It's called Red Balloon. And as you watch this video, you're going to laugh at it. You're going to laugh at the corniness of it. You're going to laugh at the craziness of some of this idea of everything being equal and everybody's ideas being true. You're going to laugh at that, at how that could possibly work, especially when it comes to this video called Red Balloon. Go ahead and check this out, and then we'll come right back.
This is a red balloon. It's true, it's red, we all know our colors. The absolute truth is that this balloon is red.
No, it's not. That's green.
What?
This right here is a green balloon.
That is the prettiest yellow balloon.
Yellow? This is red. Yeah, come over here.
No, it's green.
It's red!
Yeah, I know, it's a red balloon.
Hey, will you look at it from my point of view, please?
What?
Hey, nice blue balloon. Blue.
It's green!
Green? It's red.
What? Why are you saying it's red when it's blue?
Huh?
It's totally purple from here!
Purple? Okay, you know what? Let's just settle this once and for all, okay?
Where are you going?
Hey, what color is this balloon?
I only see in black and white.
Hey, Mark, what color?
There is no balloon.
This is ridiculous.
Hey, I know what the problem is. Look, my mom taught me that this was blue. But, you know, then she said this is red and green, yellow, you know, and on and on.
Okay, right. I get that your mom taught you that was blue, but I mean, that's not the truth.
Whoa, why are you talking bad about his mom?
Yeah.
I'm not.
Listen, I respect your mother.
Thank you.
And the way she raised you. She taught you that it was blue. Our moms taught us that it was red. Right. That's the way it goes.
I thought you said it was green.
It is green. See, I'm smart. I went to college. And in college, I learned all these different theories about color.
Really?
And my color professors, who have doctorates in color. Do you have a doctorate in color?
No.
It shows. Ooh. Okay? They can't even agree on one theory of color, so you have to look at all the different theories and pick which one works best for you. And green is great for me.
That makes sense.
Thank you.
No, you can't just pick whatever color fits your life the best. Red is red.
Okay, do you know the word intolerant?
Yeah.
Because that's what you're being right now. All right, you're shoving your opinion down my throat.
Okay, it's not my opinion, it's the truth.
Hold on. All we're saying is that we need to stop arguing about trivial things. Like truth.
You know, the funny thing about truth is, it's true, whether you believe it or not.
Well, again, that if you watch that video, I mean, it is. It's just crazy. It's ludicrous, right, to put a red balloon out in front and have people say, no, that's blue, and no, that's green, and no, that's white, and allow everybody to have their opinion and everybody to be right. In fact, this happened the other night. At my house, if you've seen this, there's pictures out there. You can get them on the internet, and they're of a dress or shoes or something, and everybody's got their opinion as to what color that dress might be. And even within our own family, I looked at it and like, no, that dress is white and gold. And Cassie looked at it and said, no, it's pink and blue. And someone, you know, Jenna, no, it's green. And we all saw the same picture, but saw different colors. And so today in 2020, okay, as we put this into today's context, taking a stand for what you believe in, especially in the context of the local church, really what we've come to is it's considered hate speech. Almost God's word and any type of absolute truth, whether it's religious or not, it's almost like it's considered hate speech. It's considered fanaticism, bigoted fanaticism, discriminatory. And all of this that we're experiencing today is exactly what the church was experiencing back in Thyatira in the first century. This is the church we're going to look at this morning. And the problem was not just that this church was facing this idea of being tolerant in the old-fashioned sense. It was actually the practice of tolerationism that threatened to bring down this small but growing and thriving congregation. And of the seven letters to the seven churches that were written by John, the book of Revelation, this letter is probably the most odd one to be included in this. Because of the 10, there were actually 10 major cities in Asia Minor. We only are looking at seven of them. In fact, Jesus, as he figured out, okay, what churches do I want to single out? What churches do I want to write letters to? He had 10 options because there were 10 major cities. And he narrowed that down to seven. And then even in those seven, you got to wonder, why Thyatira? Because it was considered the most or the least important city in all of Asia Minor. I mean, it was located about 35 miles southeast of Pergamum, which was the capital, right? The capital of Asia Minor. So it'd be like us, we're here in Beaverton, and there's Portland, and it's like, okay, we're just a suburb. Okay, we're just a suburb of Forest Grove. I mean, you keep going out to Vernonia. It's like the farther away you get, the less impact you have on what is going on in downtown Portland. Well, this is kind of what it was like in the city or the town, I'll call it a town, of Thyatira. But even though it was small, it was still a very busy commercial center because it sat on a major road in the Roman Empire. And so because of that, because it was kind of a thoroughfare, a lot of unions, or what they actually called guilds back in the first century, a lot of guilds, they settled here in this city of Thyatira. And everyone who worked in Thyatira was a member of one or more of these unions. And because of this, what basically Thyatira was, is it was a blue collar. It was very much a blue collar town, like a Pittsburgh, right? Back when steel was a major industry, right? It was kind of that blue collar. It was a working man's city made up of carpenters and tent makers and sellers of goods and dyers. In fact, maybe you remember when Paul started the church at Philippi, one of the original members of the church at Philippi was this woman named Lydia. And Lydia was a seller of purple goods, and she was from this city of Thyatira. In fact, it's possible that she was in this church when all this was going on. And as we'll see in John's letter, as we unpack it, the pressure faced by these new believers, it came from these unions. That's where the pressure came from. Because to hold or to run a business in Thyatira, you had to be a member of one of these guilds, one of these unions. And unfortunately, each union had their own god, right? They had their own deity. They had their own spiritual practice, a way to worship. And most of it was very immoral. They had their own pagan deities, and they would hold these feasts weekly. You'd have these feasts that everybody that was part of that union, every member was expected or required to show up and participate in these pagan rituals that were sacrificing meat to idols and involved sexual immorality. So these Christians at Thyatira, they were faced with a dilemma. Do I attend the feast, and do I just compromise my faith, or do I actually include some of their faith in my faith, or do I lose my livelihood? Do I lose my job? Do I become an outcast in my community? This was the issue here that Jesus is going to address here in Revelation chapter 2. So if you have your Bibles, go ahead and turn to Revelation chapter 2. We're going to start here in verse 18. But as we do that, let me go ahead and open us up in a word of prayer. Oh God, this morning I ask that you would speak to us. Lord, as we look at this idea of what it means to be tolerant, but to not compromise. God, how do we do that? How do we do that well? How do we do that in a loving way? But yet, how do we do that in an honest way? How do we balance grace and truth? So God, I ask that you would speak to us this morning. Lord, we love you. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, this letter that we're going to look at, it's funny too, because it's, even though it's written to one of the least important cities in all of Asia Minor and among these seven letters, it's actually got the most words of any of the seven letters, okay, that John wrote. So let's begin here in verse 18. We read these words. Write this letter to the angel of the church in Thyatira. This is a message from the Son of God, whose eyes are like flames of fire, whose feet are like polished bronze. I know all the things you do. I've seen your love, your faith, your service, and your patient endurance. And I can see your constant improvement in all of these things, right? In other words, this is a church that's on the upswing. This isn't a church that's struggling. Jesus says it right here. I can see the constant improvement. You're improving every day in your love and in your faith and in your endurance. But he's going to say, guys, I have this complaint against you. And let's go back to that term there in verse 18 where he's described as someone with eyes like flames of fire. Hey, eyes like a flaming fire. When I was a kid, whenever I would act unruly, if my dad was around and I was doing something I shouldn't be doing, All my dad knew this. All he had to do was catch my eyes. His flames of fire, okay, his eyes, all they had to do was lock onto mine, and I knew right then and there. Okay, I better straighten up, okay? I better get it together. I better get my act together, because if I don't, judgment's coming. Judgment's coming. And in my house, the judgment meant the belt, which and it wasn't the belt of truth, okay, like God's word. It was a belt that held up a pair of Levi's. So here Jesus is saying, with my eyes like flaming fire, I'm going to pierce that thin veil of the faithful believers there at the church in Thyatira. That, yeah, they're characterized by love. They're growing in their love and faith and service and perseverance. But with my flames of fire, I'm going to pierce that veil. Because deep down, I see a dark spot. I see a dark spot of sin that's beginning to eat away at this growing, thriving church. And also remember, okay, that most of the New Testament, when the term fire is used, the concept is purification. It's used in the context of purification, and that's what Jesus wants to do. With his eyes like a flaming fire, he's going to pierce what they're doing. Well, he's going to cut through that. He's going to get right to that dark spot that he sees, okay, that's eating away at them, and he's going to purify them, or he's going to give them the opportunity to walk through the purification process. All right, so let's continue reading here. Verse 20. It says, "But I have this complaint against you. You are permitting that woman, that Jezebel, who calls herself a prophet, to lead my servants astray. She teaches them to commit sexual sin and to eat food offered to idols. And I gave her time to repent, but she does not want to turn away from her immorality. Therefore, I will throw her on a bed of suffering. And those who commit adultery with her will suffer greatly unless they repent and turn away from her evil deeds. And I will strike her children dead. Then all the churches will know that I am the one who searches out the thoughts and intentions of every person. And I will give to each of you whatever you deserve." So here's what's going on. Evidently, there's a woman in this church who was a very dominant leader. She's, you know, maybe she's like a Sunday school teacher. Well, Jesus gives her this name, Jezebel. We refer to her as this Jezebel. And we're pretty certain this was not her real name. But what Jesus was doing is he was saying, hey, this woman, she's got characteristics much like the original Jezebel in the Old Testament, mentioned in 1 Kings chapter 16, right? The Jezebel that many of us know of, that was married to King Ahab, who ruled the northern kingdom. And as the wife of the king, what she was able to do is she was able to bring in some of her pagan worship and her ideas and her values and her beliefs. And because she was a deceptive, domineering, scheming, and vicious woman, she was able to convince her husband, King Ahab, that my religion and the Christian religion, right, the worship of the one true God, those need to mesh. Those need to go together. Those need to be seen as equal. And if you remember, it was this Jezebel who sought to have the prophet Elijah killed. After Elijah had gone up against the 450 prophets, you remember that story where he goes up on Mount Carmel and he has this contest with these prophets to figure out which God is the true God, whether it's Baal or his God, right, our God. And each of them is supposed to call down fire from heaven. Well, you know, as the story goes, that nothing happens when the prophets of Baal call on their God, but the second Elijah calls on God, fire comes down and consumes everything, including the prophets of Baal. Well, this ticks off Jezebel, and so she sets the ball in motion to have Elijah killed. Well, even as courageous as Elijah was to go up against those 450 prophets, once he realized that Jezebel was on the warpath and was going to have him killed, he ran. He ran for his life. This was how ruthless Jezebel was. So similarly here in Revelation, this Jezebel, the Jezebel of Thyatira, just like the Jezebel in the New Testament, she also was able to seduce the church, to seduce many in the church, to worship false gods, and to practice sexual immorality. This is how the great British Bible scholar William Barclay, this is how he describes how Jezebel did this. He says, apparently, Jezebel taught that it was all right for them to go along with the requirements of the guild. Remember, I talked about that earlier, right? The ritualistic, the rituals that they would, these feasts that they would have, there's rituals that they would have, that these different unions would host, and, you know, sacrificing meat to idols and sexual immorality. And so Jezebel says, hey, it's okay. It's okay that you do this. It's okay that you submit to the pressures of the world around that's around you, especially if this is the only way you can make a living. And she went on to say, because God's going to understand. She taught this. She taught that God will understand and overlook your sin, even if it involves idol worship and sexual immorality. Right? She convinced them that it was okay, that God would understand, that he'd realize that you need to make a living, and that in order to make a living, you had to commit this sin. Well, some scholars believe that this Jezebel here in Revelation represented one of the earliest Gnostic group, which flourished really more in the second century. See, Gnosticism taught that the matter, right, the body and the spirit, the soul, were completely separate, right, that the body could not be redeemed. And so therefore, salvation concerned really only our spirit. So some forms of Gnosticism reason that the spirit, because the spirit is unaffected by the body, then the body can indulge in whatever sin, whatever lust of the flesh it wants to involve itself in. It's not going to do any damage to the soul. And since God isn't concerned with our soul, then God also doesn't care what we do with our bodies. This is the teaching that infiltrated this church, and it was brought by this Jezebel. Well, what was even more concerning than this false teaching is, as I just said, the fact that they accepted it. They adopted it. This is where tolerationism hit. Right? Because it wasn't just that they agreed with it but didn't let it in. It was that they agreed with it and actually allowed it to come in. They accepted it. If you remember, last week we talked about the letter to the church at Pergamum. And you'll notice that there were similarities here between these two churches. Because each church had allowed itself to be infiltrated with false teachers that would lead the church astray. And they did this all in the name of grace, and all in the name of church growth, and all in the name of unity, and all in the name of being able to make a living, right? They didn't trust that God would provide. They felt like they needed to provide on their own because they didn't trust that God was there for them. So how bad were things? How bad were things in Thyatira? Well, obviously pretty bad. It was bad enough, actually, that Jesus reserved some of his harshest words in these seven letters for this one church. Let's read it again. Verse 22. Therefore, I will throw her on a bed of suffering. He's talking about Jezebel. I will throw her on a bed of suffering, and those who commit adultery with her will suffer greatly unless they repent and turn away from their evil deeds. And I will strike her children dead. Then all the churches will know that I am the one who searches out the thoughts and intentions of every person, and I will give to each of you whatever you deserve. Right? Suffering, judgment, right? Death. That's what was in store for these false believers, for those who didn't repent, for those that didn't follow and turn back to Jesus. Now, given the severity of this judgment, some may wonder, Doug, is there a promise here somewhere? Okay? Is God gonna give us a promise in all of this? And he actually is, and it's actually a pretty good one, probably one of the better ones in these seven letters. Go to verse 24. He says this, after you know, spewing these words of judgment, he says, but I also have a message. I also have a message for the rest of you in Thyatira who have not followed this false teaching. I will ask nothing, this is what he says, I will ask nothing more of you except that you hold tightly to what you have until I come. He says, listen, hold on. If you refuse to accommodate sin, if you refuse to stand against deception, if you follow me, then that's it. I'm not going to ask any more of you. Now, why would Jesus say that? What's the purpose of that? What's his motivation for not requiring any more of them but to remain faithful? Well, Charles Swindoll says this in his commentary on Revelation. He wrote this. I'm sure it wasn't an easy position to maintain talking about the believers at Thyatira. Keeping the peace by holding our tongues is always easier than standing our ground and confronting wickedness. This is why Christ placed no further burden on them. Remaining faithful to him in that culture of toleration was difficult enough. Right? Jesus understood. He's a merciful God. He's a gracious God. He's not going to ask us, he's not going to ask of us more than we can handle, and he's not going to do that here with the believers at Thyatira. He's saying, listen, if you can simply hang on, if you can simply remain faithful, that's good enough, because I understand. I understand the temptation, and I understand the pressure, and I understand the persecution that you are under. But that wasn't all. He goes on in verse 26 to say this, to all who are victorious, who will obey me to the very end, to them I will give authority over all the nations. They will rule the nations with an iron rod and smash them like clay pots. They will have the same authority I received from my Father, and I will also give them the morning star. Here in verse 26, Jesus is referencing Psalms chapter 2, verses 7 through 9, and he's saying, hey, if you remain faithful, here's two things for you. Two promises I will make. The first one is that you will rule with me in my millennial kingdom. Right? I will give you authority over all the nations. When I come down and I set up and I establish my earthly kingdom here on earth, you will rule right beside me. And then secondly, I will give you the morning star. Now, what's the morning star? Well, we learn about the morning star in Revelation 22 when Jesus refers to himself as the bright and morning star. So with these two promises, Jesus is saying, if you hold on, if you remain faithful, if you don't allow this type of teaching to come into the church, if you confront it, if you confront the wickedness, then I will give you both myself, I will be with you, I will stand right beside you, and you will have access. You will help me rule my kingdom. I will be with you. I will stand next to you, and you will help me rule my kingdom. Well, John's going to close this letter in the same manner that he closed all seven letters. Anyone with ears to hear must listen. And so as we're walking through this series, are you listening? Right? Are your ears open? But even more than that, right? Are you actually more than hearers? Are you doers of God's word? Are you applying what we're learning each and every day? But with this letter, what did you hear? What did you hear from this particular letter? Because as you look at this, understanding that these letters were not just written, yes, they were written to a particular church, but they were written to types of churches that have spanned all of church history. In fact, this is first century. Once we get to the sixth century, the church at Thyatira actually really comes to the forefront. And this is almost a prophetic letter, because in the sixth century, the church age is about to enter what some have called the devil's millennium, or the dark ages, or what's most commonly referred to as the Middle Ages, a time when the church became corrupt by, once again, just like the church in Thyatira, combining pagan rites and Christian teaching. It's a time when many pagan practices and heathen rituals were introduced into the church, baptized with Christian terminology, related in some way to elements of the Bible, and therefore accepted as truth. And many of these false teachings, many of these false practices sprung up, especially within the Catholic Church. But here's what I want us to understand. I want us to understand that even though what I just shared, okay, in terms of pagan rites being combined with Christian teaching between the 6th and the 16th century, mostly within the Catholic Church, you can find these same errors. You can find this same practice of tolerationism in the great Orthodox churches of the East, in the Coptic churches of Egypt, in the Anglican and Lutheran churches of Northern Europe, and even in Baptist churches of the West. No one is immune to the sin of tolerationism. No one is immune from turning a blind eye to false teaching, wickedness, and sin within the context of the local church. So my prayer for Parkside and for all the Church of the Cross Beaverton in the Pacific Northwest is threefold, and I'm going to take elements of each of the three churches that we've studied so far. And the first one is this. My prayer is that like the church in Ephesus, that we be constantly asking ourselves, have we lost our first love? Is Jesus still sitting on the throne in our church? Is Jesus still the answer to everything we say and everything we do? Like the church in Pergamum, are we asking ourselves, what does God's word say about how we're to live? What does God's word say about how we're to act? Especially now, given what we're going through with the pandemic and social unrest, what does God's word say? How does God's word say we should respond in a time like this? Are we using this as our guide? And then finally, like the church in Thyatira, is our attitude towards sin in line with God's word? Is our attitude with sin, with what is going on, does it all line up with God's word? Because when it comes to truth, moral values, and sin, if we choose to make compromises because of societal pressure, like the church in Thyatira, if we make compromises because of societal pressure or because we fear that our church may not make it, then we will never see the spiritual awakening that we long for. And so as we close this morning, know this, the purpose of this letter is not just about the purity of the local church. Right? For the church in Thyatira, it wasn't just about weeding out or keeping out sin. It was also about the repentance and restoration of sinning believers. Okay? People like you and me. So as much as we cocoon ourselves or want to cocoon ourselves and keep out the world, right? Be in the world but not of the world, we also need to recognize that there's the world's already in our churches because we're full of imperfect people. There is sin in and amongst the people of Parkside, myself included. And so we have to be constantly taking a long, hard look at ourselves. When we wake up every morning, we have to pray to God, God, forgive me. Forgive me of my sin yesterday and help me to live better for you today. Our job is to hold ourselves to Christ's standards. And as we do that, then I believe our church will have the testimony that God wants us to have within our community. If we ever find ourselves guilty of tolerating sin in our own lives or in the life of our church, then that's something that we need to come to terms with and deal with as soon as possible. And as we close this morning, I do want to return to those promises. Because to me, that's what I want to live my life for in expectation of. That one day I'll be standing beside Jesus. Like Dick Graves is right now, who just recently passed. Like Dick Graves, he's standing beside Jesus, right next to Jesus. And Jesus is saying, listen, I want you to help me rule. I want you to help me rule. I want to be with you as your Savior together forever. That's the promise that he gives each and every one of us. So let's claim that. Let's claim that and let's go out and live the life that Jesus has called each of us to live. Let me pray for us. God, I thank you for the example of these churches. God, both the good and the bad. God, but even more importantly, I thank you for the promises that you give to us as we seek to live the lives that you've called us to live. God, just help us each and every day, God, as we navigate this season that we find ourselves in, this season where we are pressured to be to practice tolerationism, God, to just let everybody believe whatever they want to believe and maybe even accept some of that as truth. God, help us to be discerning and know when to speak up, when to be bold and when to live, God, for you. God, I thank you for Parkside. I thank you for the influence that you've allowed us to have, and ask that you would continue to use us to spread your message of hope and peace and love in our community. God, we love you. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Hey, well, thanks for joining me this morning. Again, I want to invite you back next week. Larry's going to be preaching for us next week, so excited to hear God's word through my brother Larry. Enjoy the rest of your Sunday.
Oh, I've heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. Oh, and I've seen many searching for it. As you call me deeper still.